Welcome. We're glad that you are joining us, hopefully live from home and wherever you're at, anywhere across the whole world. Just we're going to ask you to stand as we sing this great hymn, How Great Thou Art.
How great thou art, then sings my soul. See how great. Facebook stream of our service this morning. Thank you for connecting with us in this way. Normally, we ask everyone to fill out one of our connection cards, but this morning we're asking everyone to do that via email. Send an email to office@gracebaptistcc.com and let us know how we can pray for you. Our ministry staff and elders pray through these requests every week. If you've seen answers to those prayers, we'd love to hear those praises too. Also, if you are aware of anyone who needs help during this emergency, please let us know so we can make sure that they are being cared for. We are trying to make sure we are communicating with you during these days when we are having to distance from each other. If you don't receive electronic communications from the church this week, we would love for you to email us and ask us and ask to be on those mailing lists. You can take yourself off at any time, but at least during this session that we cannot meet together, it's a good way for us to be able to get critical information to you all. Just send an email to office@gracebaptistcc.com and we'll get you that communication list. In just a moment, Chrissy is going to come up and talk to our kids. If they're not in the room with you right now, you want to call them in so that you can hear from her. Just before she comes up though, let's pray together. Dear Lord, we just thank you for this day and thank you for the communication that we do have. Lord, we know that you have promised us that you are in our hearts no matter where we are. You listen, you speak to us, and you will be doing that through Pastor Dean today and Chrissy and the worship team. Praise you, mighty God. This is the greatest connection we have is with you. Those that are ill and that are struggling, we just lift them up to you at this time. And we pray that people that are hearing this today, hears this message, and takes it to their heart. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Bill. Hi, everybody. I'm so glad to see you this morning. Especially to my Grace kids, I miss you so much, and I am so proud of you for making the tough choice to stay home and help protect your community right now. This week, I was thinking actually about how many choices we make in a week. Actually, it's probably more than you'd expect. I made the choice on what to wear this morning. I made the choice 3 days ago to eat probably way more Oreos than I needed to eat. Yeah, I know a lot of you are probably making those choices too, parents, I know. We get to make all of the different choices in our week because of something, a gift God gave to us, which is called free will. And that means that we get to choose between different things. And in the context of our normal lives, some of those choices are just choices, right? It's not a good or a bad thing if I decide to wear my yellow pants or my red pants today. It's just a choice. But sometimes our choices are a whole lot bigger. We're gonna play a game right now. We're gonna play thumbs up, thumbs down. So everybody, hands out, make a fist. You have a choice. I'm gonna read a scenario, which is just a made up story to make us think. And if it's a good choice, give us a thumbs up. And if it's a bad choice, do a thumbs down. Now, I can't see you, so you're gonna have to be accountable to the people in the room with you, okay? So here is, we're gonna ask five scenarios. So here's the first one, are you ready? You are playing in your room, and your mom comes in and tells you to clean up, but you choose to keep playing video games. Is it a good choice or a bad choice? Oh, two thumbs down from Mr. Mike in the sound booth. I feel like you've maybe had this choice before. Choice number two, ready? Hands out. You are taking a test at school and there is an answer that you don't know. You choose to look at your neighbor's paper. Is that a good choice or a bad choice? Bad choice. Number three, are you ready? You are doing your homework and the TV is on. It's distracting you. So you turn it off. Is that a good choice or a bad choice? It's a good choice, promise. All right, we got two more to go. Are you ready? You are playing where you're not supposed to and you break one of your mom's favorite bowls. This happened this week in my house. You decide to tell your mom you didn't know what happened. Is that a good choice or a bad choice? Bad choice. Last one, this one, maybe I should have been thinking about this last choice when I ate the last Oreo this week. Are you ready? You find the very last cookie in the package and your little sister asks you to share. You decide to break the cookie in half and give her the bigger half. Is that a good choice or a bad choice? It's a good choice, even if you end up with the smaller bit. I hope that you had fun playing with me. You know, those choices are ones that we face most days. And actually, when Pastor Dean comes up in a little bit to speak to us, he's going to tell us about a part in the Bible where we meet a man named Jethro. And Jethro had a much bigger choice to make than sharing a cookie. He had to make a choice about whether he was going to follow God and worship him, or if he was going to continue doing bad things and making bad choices. Jethro, sorry if this spoils the story for you guys. Jethro decides to make the good choice because he saw how powerful God was and how gracious God was to the Israelites. Now, we all know God is holy and good and loving, and these are some of the reasons why we should try to make the right choice ourselves, to make the good choice. Just like Jethro, we can choose whether we are going to follow God or whether we are going to go against him. We can choose to do the right thing or the wrong thing, and no one can make that choice for you. That's what free will is about. So this week, I want to encourage you, all my Grace kids, to stop and think before you make a choice. Is it a good choice or a bad choice? And are you making that choice because you love God or because you want to do the thing that's easier? All right, Pastor Dean, it's all you.
Thank you, Chrissy. Spoiler. No, that's really good. It's been said a couple of times already, but welcome to Grace, or at least Grace online. We're grateful that you've tuned in. If you're not regularly a part of our church and you've tuned in this morning, I want to especially thank you and welcome you to Grace. And when all of this craziness is over, if you live in our area and you're looking for a church, we would really love to have the opportunity of becoming your church home for you to discover what so many of us have discovered about this great little church that we have. So we hope that you'll consider doing that. We got an angry phone call this week at the church. It seems that the caller thought we were doing what that one pastor down in Louisiana was doing, where he was like having thousands of people meet at his church because he's invincible to this virus and he could heal everybody anyway. And just so you know, we're not doing that. There's nobody here. We are, in fact, everyone in the building right now is under that 10 limit, and we're well beyond 6 feet apart. So if you're that guy that called, just know we're not harming our community or the people in our church. We're going to be looking at a couple of stories. Chrissy mentioned one of them in Exodus chapters 17 and 18 this morning. If you've got a Bible at home, we'd invite you to open it to that now. There's a great Bible app that a lot of us use called YouVersion, and you can find whatever translation you like to read in there. But if you want to pull that out now, again, we'll be in Exodus chapter 17. Just before we look at that together, let me lead us in prayer. Lord, these are interesting days. They're difficult days. They are days that we need to hear from you. And we're grateful, Lord, that you choose to speak to us through your word. And we pray, Lord, that you would do that this morning, that each of us, wherever we are listening, and myself included, would hear something from you that we know is actually from the living God. And that thing, whatever that is that you want to communicate to us this morning, that it would begin to change us on the inside and work its way out into our lives as well. So speak to us this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, for those of you that haven't been with us very long, we've been in a series in the book of Exodus that we're calling Rescued to Worship. The book of Exodus is a story about God taking the people of Israel out of their slavery, 400 years of slavery in Egypt. He rescues them out of that slavery so that, and he says this over and over, so that they can worship him. And along the way, we've been noticing that we actually find our own story in the story of Exodus too, a story where we are rescued out of slavery, a little bit different kind of slavery, a slavery to sin, so that in the same way we can worship him, we can find our deepest longings of our hearts satisfied in him. Now, we've been on a break from Exodus for the last few weeks, so I need to just kind of recap where we've been so far. So in the opening chapters of Exodus, Israel is being brutally oppressed in slavery in Egypt. And God raises up this man. It's a phenomenal story, an amazing story. This man named Moses. He calls on Moses to be his mouthpiece to Pharaoh. God at this bush that's burning but not burning up, and God gives Moses some instructions for what he wants him to do. And in that conversation, Moses asks God, what is your name? Seems like a very reasonable question to ask. Who are you? And God says to him, my name is Yahweh. Some of your translations say it this way, I am. My name is I am, or as we talked about when we were going through it, I will be for you everything you need for a God to be. And there at that burning bush, God shows Moses that his shepherd's staff is going to be used to show God's power to people who are opposed to God. So now no longer is it just to kind of wrangle sheep. God's going to use it for much more important purposes. So Moses goes to Pharaoh and he says, Yahweh says, let my people go so that they may worship me. And some of you remember what what Pharaoh said back. He said, "Who is Yahweh that I should let you go? I don't know anything about him," he said. And then he said, "No, you can't go." So God answers Pharaoh's question with a series of plagues, right? So Pharaoh says, "I don't know who this God is." And God says, "Well, I'm going to show you that I'm actually more powerful." So as each plague is announced by Moses, God tells Pharaoh that it's so that you may know that I am Yahweh. I am the one true God. And as the plagues continue, the language broadens a bit, and God ends up saying, this is actually so that all of the nations will know that I am God, that I am Yahweh. So God brings these 10 plagues against Egypt, showing that he is more powerful than all of their so-called gods. And along the way, God uses Moses and his staff to show his power. So that when Moses strikes the Nile River with his staff, it turns to blood. When he strikes the ground, the dust becomes lice. When he raises his staff towards the skies, thunder and lightning and hail come down. When he raises his staff to the east, locusts come. And finally, when he raises his staff over the Red Sea, it parted so that Israel could walk across on dry ground. And then once they were all safely on the other side, he raises it again. And you know the story, the sea swallows up the entire Egyptian army. We left off a few weeks ago with Israel grumbling against God, and God showing his gracious care of them by providing food and water and rest for them. And in our story today, Israel is about to face their first battle since leaving Egypt. We know that they left with weapons. This is their first opportunity that they're going to have to use them. And though there will be many battles between now and when they actually get into the Promised Land, this is actually the only one that occurs in the book of Exodus. We're going to pick up the story at verse 8. Read along with me. While the people of Israel were still at Rephidim, the warriors of Amalek attacked them. Moses commanded Joshua, "Choose some men to go out and fight the army of Amalek for us. Tomorrow I will stand at the top of the hill, holding the staff of God in my hand." So Joshua did what Moses had commanded and fought the army of Amalek. Meanwhile, Moses, Aaron, and Hur climbed up to the top of a nearby hill. As long as Moses held up the staff in his hands, the Israelites had the advantage, but whenever he dropped his hands, the Amalekites gained the advantage. Moses' arms soon became so tired he could no longer hold them up. So Aaron and Hur found a stone for him to sit on. Then they stood on each side of Moses, holding up his hands. So his hands held steady until sunset. As a result, Joshua overwhelmed the army of Amalek in battle. And we'll stop here for a little bit and make a note of a few things before we continue on. First of all, who are the Amalekites? Amalek was the grandson of Esau. We read that in Genesis 36. So when we read that Amalek attacked, what we understand here is that it was Amalek's people, his descendants. Amalek is long dead now at this point. It's his descendants that are attacking. So Amalek is the grandson of Esau. You might remember Esau was Abraham's grandson, right? And Esau was a twin. Do you remember? Some of you probably remember who Esau's twin brother was. Jacob. Jacob, whose name was later changed to Israel. Right? So you've got Jacob and Esau who were just like this with each other and now their descendants are doing the same thing. It's like this colossal family feud, right? Historians say that the Amalekites had organized themselves into a very early, really national nomadic group. They are some of the first people to domesticate the camel and use its speed. I don't normally think of camels as fast, but I guess they are. They're some of the first ones to use the camel's speed in surprise attacks against their enemies. And verse 8 says that Amalek, or the Amalekites, attacked Israel. Okay, there's no evidence that this was a provoked attack. In fact, in Deuteronomy 25, verse 18, it recounts that this attack was actually cowardly. It says that they attacked when the people were exhausted and weary, and that they struck down those who were straggling behind. Probably, in my mind, I imagine elderly, women, children, a really cowardly move. Maybe most important to the story that we're in today, Deuteronomy 25:18 says that they have no fear of God. They have no fear of God. Now, forgive me, but this is a special kind of stupid right here. I don't know who comprised the joint chiefs of the Amalekites, the war council, right? But they're not too bright. Why do I say that? Think about this with me. As we worked our way through the Exodus event, Israel leaving Egypt, what role did Israel play in that? What did Israel actually do to get out of Egypt, to get away from their captors? Nothing. They did nothing. God was the one that did it all. He turned the water into blood. He sent frogs and lice and locusts and hail. He killed all their firstborn. And then the largest, most powerful army that had ever been amassed up to that point in history is wiped out when the Red Sea swallows them up after Israel walks through on dry land. Now, someone on the joint chiefs of this little nomadic people says, "Hey, you know, it's been several weeks since we've had us a good battle. How about we attack the Hebrews?" Somebody in the room should have said, "Hey, you know, I know they don't look like much, but I seem to remember that they have a God who fights for them. Are you sure? Are you sure we should do this?" But somehow, as they look around the room, they end up saying, "Yeah, I like our chances here," right? So as the story unfolds, Moses tells a young man by the name of Joshua to gather some of the Israelite men to go launch a counterattack. And this is the first mention of Joshua in the Bible. And it's a little strange because he's mentioned in kind of a matter-of-fact way, like we're supposed to know who this guy is, but we don't yet. We don't know anything about this guy yet. We don't know that he will become a mighty warrior. We don't know that he will actually replace Moses as Israel's leader later on. At this point, he's just a young man who obeys his leader, Moses. So Moses tells Joshua to go out and fight the Amalekites while he and Aaron and a man named Hur. I keep thinking this is funny, and maybe you won't, but it keeps sounding funny to me, kind of like Johnny Cash's song, "A Boy Named Sue, A Man Named Hur." So if you're hearing me say his name but not seeing it, it's not H-E-R, it's H-U-R. Okay. So anyway, Moses, Aaron, and a man named Hur go up on the hill with the staff of God. And this is one of those great stories from Sunday school if you grew up in church, right? So Moses is up there holding up the staff of God in the air. And as long as his hands are raised, the battle goes in favor of Israel. But whenever Moses' arms get tired and begin to lower the staff, the battle goes in favor of the Amalekites. So Aaron and the guy named Hur get a rock for Moses to sit on, and they hold up his arms in the air for him until sunset, when Joshua's men defeat the Amalekites. So what's going on here? Is this just kind of a magic trick? Is Moses just acting like, you know, some kind of spiritual cheerleader, we've got spirit, yes we do, you know, is that what's going on? Or maybe you heard this story like I did, that this story was all about prayer, that Moses' hands were raised in prayer, and as long as he prayed really hard, then everything went his way. Now, I'm pretty sure that Moses was praying. Maybe the guys holding up his arms were praying too. But I don't think that's what's going on in this story. Are we supposed to pray? Yes, we are. I'm not saying we're not supposed to pray. Are we supposed to join with each other and support each other in prayer? Absolutely. But I don't think that's what's going on in this story. I think the key to understanding this story is the staff of God that we see here in verse 9. And to understand the staff of God, we have to think about how this staff has been used so far in the book of Exodus. Time and time again, God has been using Moses' staff, or the staff of God, as this instrument through which he shows his power and even his judgment to people who oppose him. So when Moses raises his staff and hits the Nile, the water turns to blood. When he raises his staff, the frogs come. When he raises his staff, the locusts come. When he raises his staff to the sky, grapefruit-sized hailstones fall from the sky. When he raises his hand over the, raises his staff over the Red Sea, it separates, and all of Israel, maybe 1 or 2 million people, cross over on dry land. And when he raises it again, the entire Egyptian army is drowned in the sea. Even in the last story we looked at when we were last in Exodus, when Moses raised his staff and struck the rock, do you remember what happened? Water gushed out. But remember the context of that story. The people were grumbling against God. They were opposing God. They, as we saw, were actually accusing God of premeditated murder. It's crazy. And so God showed them his power, even his judgment. Everything we know about this staff suggests that it is used to show God's power against those who oppose him. And so I think we're on really solid ground this morning to believe that the same thing must have been going on in this story here that we're looking at against the Amalekites. You see? Can you see where I'm going here? When the Amalekites saw Moses with the staff of God raised over his head, you know, they've heard the stories, right? News travels fast. I think they've most certainly heard the stories of what happened in Egypt. So when they see the staff of God raised high in the air, they should have raised white flags right then and there. But they didn't. As Deuteronomy 25 says, they had no fear of Yahweh. And so they lost the battle. At the end of the story, down in verses 15 and 16, we read this. So Moses built an altar there, and he named it Yahweh Nissi, which means the Lord is my banner. He said, they have raised their fists against the Lord's throne, so now the Lord will be at war with Amalek generation after generation. I was thinking about this, and you know, I think it's really easy for us to imagine what kind of people raise their fists in opposition to God. In the last century, Jewish people saw Hitler as a modern-day Amalekite, someone who raised his fist against God and his people. There's a story told by Joseph Stalin's daughter, Svetlana, that in his last moment of life, he sat up in bed, he bolted up, and he raised his fist toward the heavens and shook it one last time. And then he collapsed back down in his bed and died. Those are the kinds of people, right, that raise their fists to God.
Hitlers and Stalins. But the New Testament also speaks of people who have no regard for God. People who, like Pharaoh, say, who is this God that I should obey him or fear him? The Apostle John, speaking of Jesus, said that in him was life, and that life was the light of men, of all humanity. And he goes on to say that the light, Jesus, shines into the darkness, but the darkness has no regard for it. The darkness doesn't acknowledge the light. John in chapter 3, verse 19, says that the people loved the darkness and hated the light. Jesus, we see, comes as the King of Kings, and what happens? The people raise their fists in the air and they say, we have no king but Caesar. And again, it's easy for us to point our fingers at those people who called for Jesus to be killed, or a Hitler, or a Stalin, or Amalekites, or Pharaoh, and say they shook their fists at God. They opposed God. I don't do that. Except here's my problem. And it is my problem. You know, when I look at all the sin lists that we find in the Bible, the lists of things that God finds abhorrent, where it speaks of people who refuse to acknowledge God, I'm on those lists. My sins are on those lists, and yours are too. So when I'm prideful or greedy or I gossip or I'm unloving or unmerciful, the Bible says, in effect, I'm shaking my fist at God and saying, I know a better way. You can't tell me what to do. And Paul says in Romans that not only do we do these things, all of us, he says we even applaud others who practice those things. My point is simply this. All of us, everyone, are guilty of raising our fists to God, of having no respect or fear of him, of saying, who is this God that I should obey him? So back to our story. Moses has built this altar to the Lord, and he named the place, the Lord is my banner, which really is a military term for the flag that will unite them, the flag that they will rally around, the flag that as they march into battle, they will be known by, right? It's a way of saying that we want to remember that if we raise our hands to the Lord, it's going to be in worship, not in clenched fists of rebellion to God. And then all of a sudden, the story takes this strange turn in chapter 18. We'll pick up the story at verse 5. Exodus 18, verse 5. Moses' father-in-law, Jethro, along with Moses' wife and sons, came to him in the wilderness where he was camped at the mountain of God. He sent word to Moses, I, your father-in-law, Jethro, am coming to you with your wife and her two sons. So Moses went out to meet his father-in-law and bowed down, and then he kissed him. This is a very affectionate but common Near Eastern greeting, right? So it makes sense. They asked each other how they had been and went into the tent. There Moses told his father-in-law all that the Lord had done to Pharaoh and the Egyptians for Israel's sake, all the hardships that had confronted them on the way, and how the Lord had delivered them. Friends, this is why chapter divisions happened, right here. This guy named Stephen Langton was a cardinal in England in the 1200s, and he thought that it would be easier to find certain sections of Scripture if it were broken up into chapters. Makes a lot of sense. So one day, Steve is sitting there reading his Bible. He's in what he has called Exodus 17. And all of a sudden, he says to himself,
This family reunion clearly has nothing to do with the Amalekites. So, boom, chapter 18. Except I think chapter 18 has a lot to do with chapter 17. And really with the whole book of Exodus and going back even further to the promises made to Abraham back in the book of Genesis. Here's what I see going on. I'm going to ask you to try and stay with me on this. Okay? We already know that Israel are descendants of Abraham, right? Abraham's grandson, Jacob, is renamed Israel. So they are part of this descendant line from Abraham. In chapter 17, we saw that the Amalekites are also descendants of Abraham. So Amalek was Esau's grandson. Esau was Abraham's grandson, right? So here we've got Israel, one part of the family of descendants from Abraham. We've got Amalek, another part. And here in chapter 18, we have another descendant of Abraham show up in the story. Genesis 25 tells us that Midian, who the Midianites were named from, descended from, Midian was one of Abraham's sons. Midianites are Abraham's descendants too. So here in these back-to-back stories, we have three nations who have all descended from Abraham's offspring. One of them has vowed allegiance to Yahweh, saying that he will be their banner, right? One of them, the Amalekites, have no regard for Yahweh, and they have raised their fists in opposition to him. What about Jethro, the priest of the Midianite religion? The Midianites' religion was closely aligned with the Moabites' religion. They had many gods, multiple gods. But among them, among the top ones, were Baal and Ashtoreth. And we know that the Moabites practiced human sacrifice, really grotesque worship to their so-called gods. It's not clear to us that the Midianites did that. But what is clear is that Jethro is a pagan priest. And it's really significant in this story. Israel has raised a banner to Yahweh. The Amalekites raised their fists against Yahweh. What will Jethro do? Let's continue reading at verse 9. Jethro rejoiced over all the good things the Lord had done in Israel. Done for Israel when he rescued them from the power of the Egyptians. Praise the Lord, Jethro exclaimed, who rescued you from Pharaoh and the power of the Egyptians and snatched the people from the power of the Egyptians. Now I know, he says, that Yahweh is greater than all gods because he did wonders when the Egyptians acted arrogantly against Israel. Then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, brought a burnt offering and sacrifices to God. And Aaron came with all the elders of Israel to eat a meal with Moses' father-in-law in God's presence. Folks, this is an amazing story here. When Jethro hears about all that Yahweh has done, and notice when Moses is telling him the story, when he tells Jethro the story, it's all about God. Nothing about what Israel has done, because they didn't do anything. God has done it all. And when he's done telling this story, when Jethro hears about it, he gets converted. This Midianite priest who offers sacrifices to the Baals and to Ashtoreth, the queen of heaven, says, now I know that Yahweh is greater than all other gods. God had said back in chapter 9 of Exodus that the plagues were so that the nations would know that Yahweh is God. And here it is playing out right in front of us, right? Many
commentaries go so far as to say that this is the first conversion in the Bible as a result of sharing the gospel, the good news. That's what gospel means. It simply means good news. Verse 9 tells us that Jethro was responding to the report or the news of the good that God had done when he brought Israel out of slavery. But I think this morning there's something even more significant that was going on deep inside Jethro. Because I think somehow, as he's hearing this, he's saying, I want that. I want to experience the same kind of deliverance that Israel has seen. I think it's more than just him being happy for Moses and Moses' people. We don't know for sure what was going on in his mind, but I sort of imagine Jethro thinking, you know, Baal never did anything like that for me. They promised me that worshiping Ashtoreth would change my life. I've been offering sacrifices night and day for all these years, and nothing has changed. Somehow, Jethro believed that worshiping Yahweh would be different, and it was. Verse 12 tells us that after he had sacrificed to Yahweh, he and Moses and Aaron and the elders sat and ate this sacred meal together in the presence of God. What an amazing little statement here in Exodus 18. None of the other gods that Jethro had worshipped had ever done that. I mean, on one hand, he could see them with his eyes, carved out of wood or cast in metal. But he knew there was really nothing behind that facade. This was different. He was in the presence of the living God. And by the way, next week we're going to partake together in the sacred meal that Jesus gave to us. A meal where, according to 1 Corinthians 10:16, we have fellowship, koinonia is the word, with Christ at that table. If you want to partake in that meal with me, I'm going to ask you to do some preparation for that, because as you worship with us from home, I'm going to ask you to have some bread and wine or juice or something that you can drink to symbolize the cup of salvation. I have never in my years of ministry done communion this way, but we serve a big God, and I think God can work with it. Okay. So next week, come prepared with that. I want to bring this to a close. Throughout our study in Exodus, we keep reminding ourselves that we need to see our own story in the story of the Exodus, right? So I'm going to ask you this question. Who do you identify with in this story? Are you Israel? Someone who has recognized that Yahweh is the one true God and that his son Jesus is our true Passover lamb that we learned about a few weeks back? If so, maybe you find yourself still on occasion raising a fist against God. Israel did it. We do it. So maybe this morning it's time for you instead to raise a banner to the Lord, declaring that he is who you will center and order your life around. Or maybe this morning you're more like the Amalekites. And as I've been talking, inside you're thinking, who is this God he's talking about? I don't need him. I don't fear him. I'm doing just fine on my own. Maybe as I'm talking, maybe you're even having some feelings of anger sort of begin to stir up in you. Maybe you want to go on an attack because you're angry about anyone who would say, you need this God. I just want to say, I hope that works out better for you than it did for Pharaoh and the Amalekites. It won't. I can pretty much promise you that. You can pray to whomever you pray to that you'll have different results, but I don't think you're going to get different results. Or maybe this morning, you'll find yourself like Jethro. You'll realize that the gods that you've been serving and slaving for haven't done a thing for you. They keep making these empty promises, and you just keep growing more and more empty inside. I don't know who those gods are for you. Maybe it's money. Maybe it's a claim, affirmation. Maybe it's a relationship. Maybe it's addictive behaviors, substances, or even sex. But it hasn't satisfied, has it? I mean, you're still empty. So do what Jethro did when he heard the good news. When he heard that there was a God who loves you and wants to rescue you from all of that. Recognize that Yahweh is the only true God. And tell him, I want that. I want what only you have to offer. What the Bible says is abundant life through his son Jesus. Our worship team are going to lead us in a couple of sung prayers, and this first one, it's such a great prayer. It's a prayer that simply acknowledges that we need God, that I need God, and it really sums up what the Christian life is all about. It's just this, it's admitting that I can't, but God always can. David, would you lead us in this prayer, please?
Those of you who are regularly a part of our community of faith here to remember to drop your tithes and offerings in the mail, send them into the church so that we can continue to do the good ministry that we are trying to do in this community. Even though we are not meeting together, all of those things that we're trying to do are still going on, and your support of those ministries is really, really appreciated. I also want to say this. If any of you this morning need prayer or just need to talk to someone, please don't hesitate to call or email the church office. We are here to help. And so now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. We go into our week now to love and serve the Lord. Amen.